This morning, and thank you for the committee for selecting me to have this chance to meet you all. I'm going to take you through a few points with my own understanding of social innovation and why is the world now moving toward that. And I have been going for this for the past 15 years since I started university. When I was a child, we used to play with a magnet, as we all did. And it's so fascinating to see the power of the magnet move things around without any physical wires. And also at the same time, it was frustrating because we cannot dismantle it, we cannot take it apart to understand what's going on. So we had to rely on our imagination to understand what's going on and explain what we see and what does it mean. Even asking your teacher about explanation of the magnet was not satisfying because the understanding of our science is not complete. The size of the unknown is huge, vast, and we only know a small bit of it. I'm surprised really by our lack of change approach. Our confidence with our great theories may be too much, making us overestimate what we know and ignore experiments, our observations that don't conform. I'm really getting worried because that's some of the core truth about what we have, about our foundation theories that we use for our modern technology have not changed over a century. They are frozen in time, collecting dust. Maybe a clue to this, why is this? Because our scientific lack of confidence that we have elevated the heroes in the past to such a height, and it takes extraordinary confidence to think one can do better. So a new amazing ideas of imaginative scientists who don't come from the right place or who didn't go to the right university or who claim to break scientific laws tend to be thrown away and shut down in flames. Some would say this is a scientific process. However, I think we are still being open to wonderful, powerful, extraordinary ideas. We ignore new evidence and follow scientific heroes because we are safe and strong on the shoulders of giants. I believe the antidote is to fire up our imagination. Start to paint a completely new picture of the future. We need to keep humanity evolving. The fuel for scientists' imagination is observation. And the value is when we are truly open, letting the deepest meaning of nature come to the surface so we can continue to create an amazing technology and engineering to fit people way of life. I would say social innovation has helped me to see a clear vision of the complex world. What is social innovation? It's about building the strategies, concepts, ideas that strengthen civil society, which then satisfies social needs such as working condition, education, community, and health. So let us look at the historical roots of the social innovation. An example of a Western social innovator comes from the 18th century, Benjamin Franklin. He was an author, a printer, politician, scientist, inventor, civic activist, statesman, soldier, and diplomat. He created innovative technologies such as bifocal lenses, the lightning rod, and the Franklin stove. And he started the first public Lincoln Library, U.S. University, and Fire Department. Hence, solving community problems was very important to him. Later, social innovation was written about in the 19th and 20th century by Peter Drucker and Michael Young. He was behind the Open University, a university education broadcast television set in 1960s and 1970s. It was an amazing idea, transforming lives. So why is such an innovation now in the news? The world's population has grown from 250 million in the 8th century up to 7 billion today, 28 times. The world is now facing famine, war, killing viruses, and depression. Sorry, very tough life for the people in the East and the West. This is worsened by the market crash. Thus, the way we live and do business is being questioned. Can we use social innovation to improve the human condition? Can we improve our lives? Social innovation is very complex, with many social and technology factors to consider. One factor is behind often the breakthroughs is science. As you've seen in the video when I said, some fear science is out of reach, but this is not true. Because nowadays it's different, science is different, it's become more human. Because thank God for the biotechnology and nanotechnology that is changing our world. Nanotechnology, for example, control very small things that you cannot see to make a big difference in society. But if you look closer, many people in the world are deprived of the benefit of science and technology, especially the developing world. So being smart and having resources is not enough for true breakthrough innovation to change people's lives. We need to aim science at social issues in order to make the impact. Then we can customize science to people's needs according to their infrastructure and way of life. We need science targeted at social issues. So from the start, science links to society. And here I always ask this question. What is the role of women within science and society? What world did they face back then and now? Back then, women were most certainly inspiring scientists who had asked clever questions about the world to feed their curiosity. Many female anthropologists, physicists, and chemists are documented in the Eastern and Western literature that are not widely known. They all celebrated education. They gave knowledge to lift people away from hardship. For example, in the 8th century, 10 centuries before Benjamin Franklin, a woman opened the first university in the world to help liberate people with the power of knowledge. Her name is Fatima al-Fihri, Umm al-Banin, Arabic lady who migrated from Fars to Morocco from Qarawan, and she built the University of Qarawan with money inherited from her father, a wealthy businessman. They taught our ancestors grammar, medicine, maths, astronomy, chemistry, history, geography, and music, and later social and natural sciences, physics, and foreign languages. And soon after, her sister, Maryam Umm al-Banin, founded another university, the second in history, Jamia al-Andalus. They are powerful examples of social innovation in themselves. And the scientists born there allowed us to innovate even more. Here, social innovation was truly catalyzed by this woman. So, woman, you really should be proud. Now, and over the last century, women scientists have faced many challenges. Not until the 1940s, for example, most top scientists, women, could only reach associate professor, irrespective of their talent. There were obstacles in the system. Because the male dominated the faculty, it was a gentleman profession. They had never had them, never wanted them, never known what to do with them, never shared scientific data with them. By the 1980s, the women's movement began, and they received more recognition. But women still have to work very, very hard to improve themselves, to get grants, equipment, to get promotion and tenures. But what stands out about women, all of this, is they are missing from leadership role. They really decide about the aim of strong scientific teams, about the aim of science. What happened to her nerve, her self-confidence, her leadership skills, her ability to believe in the evidence of her intelligence? Let us look at the grades in high school since 1990. On the left-hand side, our clearest test of ability. The grade from 1990 in science and maths increased for both boys and girls, but the girls are leading the boys. On the right-hand side, we also see more women than men are leaving with their college degrees in science and maths. There are the fact our colleges find women are better in science and maths. But have a look at the relative number of women scientists as a Nobel Prize winner compared with men. I'm sad to say women are in minority. Only 17 of them over the last century relative to 536 men. That's only 3%. But what it concerns me the most is that the scientific decision makers, the opinion leaders of the world, have less women. How does the lack of women scientists impact society? I believe women's talent, their passion, curiosity, empathy, and caring is being lost from our society. Now, only a few women are leading the way in scientific businesses, research institutions, and universities, limiting the growth of social innovation. So let's bring more women to lead science and to drive the fruit of social innovation. And here's an example. When airbags were introduced, they were designed by a largely male team of decision makers. And although these airbags protected men in accidents, they resulted in avoidable death for both women and children. Not until the women became decision makers, she protected women and children as well to save life. That's the way she did. Here I would like to say, what is my role and how can I help drive this path forward? I guess from the video, you have a little bit idea about my journey. So I would like to talk a little bit about it and how it led me to become in social innovation. As you see, I come from Mecca. I grew up in a family of 8 children with traditional upbringing and enormous love for knowledge. And since I was a little, I really admired scientists who did something amazing for humanity. So I wanted to be like them, to make a difference in the world. So I asked my father to send me abroad to follow my dream to become a scientist. This wasn't an easy, as I had no clue about what to do about it, and I had no word of English. When I arrived in Britain, I thought everything going to be rosy and all the doors would be open for me. Very naive way. But it wasn't the case. My Saudi qualification was not good enough, and I didn't have a word of English. So I was rejected, and also they told me religion doesn't go with science, it's not fashionable. They wanted to indicate that they know the fate of my life, and they want me to believe it. I was not ready to go back because I really wanted to follow my dream. And I thought about it and I said to myself, all the universities are made of human beings, just like me. If they can make it, then I can. So I studied really hard that year. I never wanted in my life anything to pass my high school again. They asked me to do the high school again. And I managed and I passed them all. And I went to King's College London and I graduated with honors in pharmacology. And I was lucky also to receive full scholarship from Cambridge University in the UK when I graduated with PhD in biotechnology. And also I was recognized I was asked by great labs in the world to collaborate, like NASA, Sandia, Berkeley University, Sandia Lab, Institute of Technology in Tokyo, a Weizmann Institute, Euromedica in Switzerland, and Department of Health in England regarding the mad cow disease. And I was called by Kim Abdullah, the gifted, and I was asked by Prince Philip to join the Royal College of Teachers in St. James Palace. And I was also recognized by the House of Parliament to be one of the top 15 scientists. And I started my own company in Cambridge to design diagnostic tool in biotechnology. I also get a prize from Prince Khalid for science. And I was so happy to receive, because you know, all of us have grown up to watch National Geographic documentary. And in 2011, I was announced by National Geographic and National Geographic Image Explorer. And I'm also a member with the Nifty 50 here in America, where I inspire girls to inspire them to do science. And I'm so thrilled to be part of that. And with Vital Voices as an ambassador to, you know, to empower them around the world. As you see also in 2012, I was announced the first Goodwill Ambassador for Sciences from UNESCO. And it was a history, a remarkable one. The king selected 30 women to be first ever in Saudi Arabia in history, part of the parliament. And this year I was announced to be on the scientific board for the US General Secretary of the United Nations, among another 26 scientists. And last month I was awarded the Global Citizen Awards from the Bill Clinton Foundation. Why I'm mentioning all of this? It's very important to remain who you are, to be proud of your culture, and also recognize other beautiful cultures have beautiful things to offer. And also, it's very important to believe in yourself and resonate passionately with the clear vision of your dream, and keep going toward that dream because the impact is huge. And a lot of people said to me, you know, you achieve your goal, you have your PhDs, it's back, it's now going. That's the end of the road. For me, it's the start to give back to society what I have gained. 2006, I moved to Harvard and I worked in a very amazing lab, Whiteside Lab. And then we came with the invention. We won with this invention both competition, MIT 100K and Harvard Social Enterprise. And you could see here, we say witness history, which is the first time a team won both competitions in the same year. This invention is made of paper, and with this invention, we want to help the poor people around the world. And we established an NGO company called Diagnostic World, and the mission of this is to design low diagnostic tool to mental health around the world, so we can save lives. Yet, when I left Harvard, I still felt the full potential of social innovation has not been achieved. Scientists still fixed in their careers, getting tenure, making publication. I remember I was asking them to think out of the box and use their imagination and to open to the science of our developed world changing too. And I know this type of change is not going to happen overnight. So I took a practical step and started Institute for Imagination and Ingenuity for Youth in the Middle East. My passion in life is to make the impact of science more tangible to every single human in the world. So I've been imagining the details of the Institute for the past 10 years, collecting ideas, being engaged with so many individuals, being truly inspired, energized by everybody involved, with big, clear goal in mind to create the ecosystem for entrepreneurship and social innovation for scientists, engineering, technologists, and communities. So that every scientist, technologist, and engineer have a chance to create a new company, to start a new market, and fulfill their dream, and to see their ideas transform to the heart of community. I was so lucky this year to graduate 6 change agents who their technology really affecting society and their community in water, in health, and environment, and in energy. To summarize, practically from my own experience, hear what I think helps bring the best change for the future. I believe it starts with people's needs in the local communities that drive the need in innovation. Only people of the community recognize what real needs are. And this is why we need to seed science in those communities. We realize starting with the great ideas of science is not enough. Instead, starting with the problems of the local communities is what is needed. Then once we have spotted the need in the communities, we need something else. Our imagination. To find that sparkling solution, the highest level of imagination. This highest level of imaginative thinking is a crucial for a sustainable world. We not only need to think out of the box, we have to think out of the box. Through this journey as a scientist, I have always been asked how to innovate. What exactly should I do to move things forward? And I always ask myself, who is the true scientist? I believe for the scientist, it's not enough to sit in that quiet lab code doing research alone. We need to be out there talking to people, to feed, to feel them, and to understand their needs, to inspire them and put over our understanding, ideas, and results to work in the real world. For me, becoming a scientist and understanding science gave me the tool to see the big picture. I realized that I could use it to bring benefit to many others, not just only for myself. Finally, I would like you to define imagination in this way. It's the confidence to dream to what people say no to, but you have the confidence to achieve it. And if someone says no, it doesn't mean that you're wrong. It means maybe there is something missing in their life, they haven't recognized it. On the other hand, if they say yes, maybe they want you to improve something that already exists. So it may be not the opportunity you're looking for. So keep going against people's rejection, because by doing that, you're going to reveal the missing part. It's going to change not only their life forever, but the world for a better one. And if you keep hearing no, that helps your compass. Rather than its meaning failure, and there is no point in going on. It shows what people cannot see. You can. And therefore, where you can lead them forward. Thank you very much.